Today's LLS is by Mr. Rajiv Khanna. Rajiv Khanna did his B.Tech in Chemical Engineering from IIT Madras 1968 batch. He is the founder of two very famous brands, Kwality Ice Creams and Kwality Milk Foods Ltd. Mr. Khanna is also a well-known investor and was featured in Forbes magazine as a wealth wizard. I would like to welcome him on stage and request him to enlighten us with his journey. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Certainly a privilege and honor to be called and come and speak to you. But it's a great reputation that one speaks to IIT students. I am an accidental IITian, and I think I'll explain that a little later. But it's certain, thank you very much for having called me. My situation was, I'm a great fan of Sherlock Holmes, and I've been seeing this particular serial, which is Sherlock Holmes set in the modern times, where he and Watson are sharing and so on. And one particular day, there is this Inspector Lestrade, which is there. He gets a message from Sherlock Holmes, help me. And he's amidst a very major arrest at that particular point of time. And he leaves everything and rushes to Sherlock Holmes, because Sherlock Holmes is somebody who doesn't ever call for help. Normally, he's very, very self-sufficient. So he walks in to Sherlock Holmes' house in flat in 221B Baker Street, and finds Sherlock Holmes relaxing. He says, what's the problem? He says, look, I have a problem. I have to make a speech. Dr. Watson is getting married, and I have to make a speech, and I've never made a speech earlier. So somewhat similar. Fortunately, I run a small business. I fortunately don't have to speak, but so be it. And here I am. Every man has a story to tell, and therefore I also have a story to tell, and I will therefore tell you my little story, good or bad, and I hope you find it fascinating. My father was in the judiciary, therefore we used to be in Punjab, and I would shift houses every 2 years or 3 years. I had my early education in Firozpur, Ambala, and then finally in Delhi. And it was in those days, by the year 10th, my father got transferred to Chandigarh, and therefore I had to stay with my aunt, and I did my last, the 11th class of higher secondary, it was called, in Delhi. And since everybody else was applying for IIT, I also decided to apply, knowing that, you know, maybe something would happen, but it was more because others were applying. I was a below average student in the family, above average student in the school, but nothing great about it. So when I went to IIT, I found that everybody had taken coaching classes and so on and so forth, and I was very, very sure that I wasn't going to get into IIT because I had done none of those things. I was so sure about it that there were four exams at that particular point of time, and the final exam was on 2 to 4 in the afternoon, which is probably an English exam, and I had fixed up with my friends that I'm going to go and see a med issue at 3:30. So I went into the final hall, and I found that I had misplaced my admit card. And I very despondently walked back to the place in Delhi, which was about a kilometer away on a dirty Delhi road, and despondently looking down and seeing maybe I'll find that admit card. And I was just plain lucky enough to find that admit card, and that's how I finally managed to write the exam. But of course, I did go and attend the med issue, so therefore, that's how seriously I was taking, I thought, were my chances of getting into an IIT. And then, as luck would have it, we were holidaying in a place called Dalhousie, because in judiciary you have 2 months vacation. And somebody was nice enough to send us my interview call, and it reached in Madras, in Dalhousie in Himachal, 1 day earlier, and I took a train and landed up in Delhi. And they said, listen, if you've got to do chemical engineering, you've got to come to Madras. And that's how I landed up in Madras. Having landed up in Madras, what did happen was I felt unwell. And I went to the doctor, and he said, how are things? And I said, listen, I'm not too happy. I'm not feeling well. I am going home. So this was unheard of. And therefore, they thought I was being dragged very badly, which was fortunately not the case in my case. The director heard about it. There's some student planning to go back. And I had written us, in those days, there were no telephones. And I written a letter to my father, I am coming back. And for next 10 days, he would go to the bus stand every day thinking that I would land up in that bus. But these guys, therefore, decided to ask me, convince me to stay. And maybe I was just too lazy to anyway pack my luggage and go. And I stayed back there for the next 5 years. And that was it.
there was nothing great about my IIT education. I was an average student. But there was one particular year in which I thank all the authorities in IIT for it. And it was in my third year. My brother was getting married, and therefore I had to miss one exam, and I think the subject was kind of. That particular subject, because I missed one exam and therefore my marks were not sufficient. I was fortunate, I didn't know I got passed, and I moved to the fourth year. A fellow student of mine who failed that year told me, listen, you were one shot mark short that particular year, and we had the authorities decided to give you that one mark extra as a grace mark, and therefore I passed out in 5 years. That changed my life. So thank you very much, everybody in IIT, for giving me that one grace mark. So thank you very, very much. So I was a very average student. I'll tell you how average I was. In a class of 40, my rank was 20th. That's how average I was. Okay. So when you pass out of IIT in those days, there were not great jobs to do so. I only had two interviews. One was for interview from a company called Hindustan Lever, who landed up here. And there were about three or four of us selected for a final interview in Bombay, which was a great thing. You went there, they gave you a first class fare, which was some pocket money, and they also gave you an allowance of maybe 30 rupees a day for attending the interview. But it so happened that they decided that none of us were good enough, they didn't select any one of us. So that was it, and therefore I was unemployed, sitting at home doing nothing. The second interview was a new company called Jagajit Industries. They had engaged the consultants, and the consultants said, you've got to get students from IIT. So they also came here, and I had no response from them. I attended an interview with them. Then after, from April or May or whatever time, October, I had no job. And I was just sitting, learning German, and sleeping, and just doing nothing. And my parents were getting very worried. My brother said, listen, this fellow is no good. But it so happened I called them up and said, all right, fine, maybe he's a nuisance, come and join us. And so therefore I got my first job in a company called Jagajit. This is a liquor making company in Punjab. And I went there and I was working as a management trainee. It was great fun. I learned a lot about whiskey. I learned a lot about everything. I was working on vodka. I was working on how to make beer. And it was very exciting. And I enjoyed that bit. It was great, great fun to be so. So this, and also we were making products like Ovaltine, which is also very, very exciting. So that was my first exposure also to the milk industry. And this was, again, there were perhaps the luck plays life. And there was a particular division, distillery, where I used to normally work. And one particular afternoon, I walked out of the distillery and went into the so-called lab. And boom, the entire distillery blew up. And about 8 or 10 of us died, my fellow workers. We all went in, forgetting the fact that again it could blow up. There was a lot of liquor being stored, but we were trying to fight the fire. Fortunately, it didn't blow up, and I'm here today. So that was it. I worked there for 11 months, and then there was this very nice company called ICI, which was a conglomerate at that particular point of time, into explosives, sterling, and also fertilizers and rubber chemicals. So it was a great job, and I went to Calcutta and they interviewed me and I got selected in it. So this was nice. They posted me in a place called Gomia. And in Gomia, I joined as a management trainee. Management training, these English companies was a great thing to happen. You didn't have to do very much. What you did, the management training of 2 years, was first you learned how to do, drink a lot of beer and a lot of whiskey. So that's what we did. But at the same time, they were very good in the sense that some of the best managers and some very learned people were your bosses. And therefore you saw by example how they conducted themselves, and therefore that was a great experience. So I did all sorts of, and you could do whatever you want to do. And after 2 years, they posted me in research. And I was doing research in industrial explosives, and that was very satisfying. I was developing all sorts of newer explosives and so on. And that was 8 years of my life. And it was great fun. It was exciting. You went to coal mines and saw how explosives interacted and so on. So one or two interesting problems I did. One during as a management I did was something called Monte Carlo simulation of the number of cars that were required. So you were given a free hand, you do what you like as long as you've been trained for it. And in 77, they decided to put up a pharmaceutical plant in Madras. And I was fortunate to come to Madras, and I was involved in commissioning a pharmaceutical plant. Now, I wasn't anything great in Gomia, but for some reason or other, my boss thought I was great. And he put me into something called an A-list, which A-list meant that these were the guys who were supposed to be the future directors of the company. I don't know what he found me, but that was it. And I came here and I was trying to commission this pharmaceutical plant, and I struggled like hell. I was more a research guy, and here I was put into production. I had never seen all this. And for 3 years, I struggled. Every morning I would go in 8 o'clock, come back at 8 o'clock at night, and I could never do anything right. But it was a learning process, but it went on. So it was in the year 1980 that I decided that I shall get into business. And my wife was from a family which used to make quality ice creams in Calcutta. So I decided to put up a quality ice cream factory in Madras. So how did we start? We took a small shed of 3,000 square feet in a place called Vadapalmi. And it was just 3,000 square feet. That's it. And I started going there. I had some very old equipment, and I had a cold storage which was not functioning well. There is, in ice cream industry, there's something called a continuous freezer. Mine was so bad that if I walked out of that particular production hall, my workers said this continuous freezer stopped working. So I had to virtually spend my entire day in front of the continuous freezer making sure it made the ice cream. And I had a cold storage which needed such fine-tuning that you were not knowing whether next day the ice cream will still be frozen and the entire ice cream will melt. And there's nothing that I could do because there's no space to put up a second cold storage and attend to it. And therefore, if you close down this, you are no longer in the business. But there was only one thing that we did have. I had burnt my bridges. I had nowhere to go to. And there was absolute grit and determination that I would land up every day at 8 o'clock. I would land up on Sundays and work very hard on it. And we had tough competitors. We had that particular point of time had Dasa Prakash. We had Joy. And they were relatively far established, well-established players. But all that we had was that ability to work hard. There was no money in the business, but somehow or other, having burnt your bridges, you had nowhere to go to, and I would do that. So by 82, 83, I had set up another factory in Bangalore. This fortunately was a little better than the previous factory, and the cold storage here was working nice, better, didn't have the sort of problems. We automated it and things like that. So this carried on. I mean, the business was doing so, and this carried on till 88, 89. And then 88, 89, a new competitor emerged, a guy with a brand called Arun Ice Creams. Now this guy was a self-made man. He started with nothing, but he started making small candies, but he created a great market all over Tamil Nadu. And he had never bothered to be in Madras city. So while we North Indians did not know the great market that existed in smaller towns, he created one of the best infrastructures of supplying to every rural market. And all of a sudden, when he came in, he spent immense amount of money, which was probably about 30% of turnover, on TV advertising. And he created an entirely new supply chain, which meant exclusive ice cream parlors. He recognized the fact that at that particular point of time, the evolution of society, ice cream was not an impulse purchase. It was a planned purchase. A family wanted to go out, they would go and spend an evening, and they spent maybe 30 rupees, and four of them could eat an ice cream, and that was it. And this was virtually a knockout punch, and I said, listen, we will not survive. But then one fine day, I said, listen, we have no other option. If we are going to close down, so might as well give it the best shot. So I went the next day to the office and I said, I'm no longer bothered whether we're making profit or loss. Let's go ahead and concentrate as much as marketing, even if we make losses. And then we didn't see back yet after that. He started growing at a fantastic rate. And we and him would run neck to neck with each other. And our advertising budgets also became very comparable to his. I remember, taking out a full page color ad in Hindu, which on those days would cost about 3 lakhs of rupees, which was a very big sum. Today it will cost you about 2 crores. And this guy calling me up and saying, listen, Khanna, damn good, you're doing a great advertisement, so let's make the market grow faster. So this carried on and we started doing a fairly good business. I'd also set up another factory in Coimbatore by that particular point of time. We're selling our ice creams all over Kerala, everything. And this was year 93, 94. And then we heard that Hindustan Lever is going to enter ice creams. Now Unilever was the world's largest manufacturer of ice creams. Hindustan Lever had one of the best marketing setups in India, and we definitely did get worried about it. And I was managing it in South India. In the rest of the country, other people making quality ice creams, we all decided to sell off our business. So, 95, I sold my business to Hindustan Lever. I sold my business to Hindustan Lever at 1.5 times my sales. In retrospect, I sold it at Moby 40% of its fair valuation. I know valuations a lot better now being in the stock markets. If I had to sell it for 100 rupees, I sold it for 40 rupees. So Hindustan Lever got a damn good deal. Having sold the business, I went into a bit of a depression. And for next 2 months, I did not deposit the checks that Hindustan Lever had given to me. And I didn't know, and my wife was saying, what's wrong with you? Why are you not depositing the checks? So I once went there, and Mr. K.K. Dadi Seth, who was the chairman of Hindustan Lever, he was a very nice person, but he sweet-talked me into this terrible deal. But so be it. And I told him I have not deposited the check. He says, why are you make Hindustan Lever rich? Anyway, I deposited the checks, and I said, listen, I'm 50 years old, or whatever, 49 or 50 years old. I maybe got 5 years or 7 years of my more working life, and I therefore decided to set up a milk plant. And I left the office and started working on this particular milk plant. And I had a youngster assisting me on this project. And we said, listen, this land that we have is agricultural land, and we're going to put up a factory. And how can we do that if tomorrow the government doesn't convert it into industrial land? We will be stuck completely. This youngster, who was from a small village in Tamil Nadu, he said, no, sir, we will go ahead and do that. He gave me the encouragement, and despite the fact we had not converted the land, we decided to do it, and then we applied for it. Fortunately, we got it converted, and that's how I got into milk business. Also at the same time, Hindustan Lever came back to me and said, listen, you got these 4 factories, we would like to give it back to you, and will you please manufacture ice cream for us? Because I think if they kept these factories as Hindustan Lever, they would have to pay them Hindustan Lever salaries, and it was not working out for them. And it was perfectly all right for me, because I needed the organization to set up this particular milk factory. And therefore, they gave me the factories, and which was meant to be an arrangement for a year or two, but then that arrangement carried on till 2008, and I continued to make quality Walls ice cream for them till the year 2008. So having set up this milk business, it was meant to be there for 3-4 years or whatever it is, and I was supposed to retire at the age of 57, 58. But things kept happening. One day we found that our competitor was putting up a milk powder plant, and now which meant a very large investment again. And I said, listen, should we be doing it or should we not be doing it? And the answer was very clear to us that if we did not put it up, all our investment would go down the drain, because every farmer would say, listen, during flush season, you're not taking milk from us, and they will all go away to our competitor. So therefore, we took a positive step and decided to put up a milk powder plant. So it kept happening that as life would go on, from milk powder, you went to UHT milk, from UHT milk, you went to yogurts, you virtually every product that we want to make, today we can make it in our ice cream factory. And therefore, that was the chapter as far as my milk industry or my business was concerned. The only thing gratifying about all this is today I have a factory with a connected power load of about 3000 HP. I employ about 150 to 200 people, and thousands of farmers are dependent on us, and it's gratifying more because I used to work in ICI, and the particular factory, which pharmaceutical factory that I was working in, had a total connected load of maybe 1,200 HP. So I think that's very gratifying that I've built a business of the size which is much bigger than the company that I used to work in. And today, if I was to decide to sell off my business, probably my company is worth a lot more than what Jagajit is today. So therefore, to that extent, it's been gratifying. But it keeps me very, very busy. But there is a slight, again, thing, I think, where IIT comes in. Maybe it was about 10 to 12 years back or 13 years back, there was this particular alumni function where Professor Sudarshan came and spoke to us. And the point he made was that, look, if an IIT graduate works to earn a livelihood for himself, then it's a waste of IIT education. And I thought, I saw that as a point. And he said, look, you IIT graduates are supposed to transform the country. Well, I don't know if I'm doing any transformational, but I'm definitely today helping to bring a certain amount of, you know, wealth in the rural sector. When we started off the milk business, Arvind, who was a major competitor, would pay the farmers 5 months or 6 months after they supplied milk. Today, every private sector dairy gives the milk on the 12th day to the farmer, and he gets it in his account, and he gets a message, this amount of money is done there. Today, he has choices. Whoever gives him more milk, the best rates, he goes to him. Whoever gives him animal feed at subsidized rates. So therefore, Tamil Nadu did not have milk. Today, it is probably the third largest producer of milk in the country. So therefore, we and other private sector dairies have done this particular bit. But having said this, if you think anybody comes and thanks you for it, nothing at all. The regulators think you're already criminals and they keep coming after you every second day. So therefore, don't expect anything out of this, but please keep working on it. There is no other way. If India has anything, I think it is the willpower of all of us, and therefore I think it's extremely exciting to run your own business. You must do that, huh? And that's it. I come to my second part, which I think I'm more known for, and probably I'm being invited today, and which is my investment career. And I had never seen any money during the period that I ran Kwality Ice Creams, to be honest with you. If you made 100 rupees in ice cream business, the business needed 200 rupees the next year. So therefore, I never had any money. I still remember at one particular point of time, we had applied for a bank loan, and all of a sudden the bankers said, listen, your company is going to go bust. So I said, no, we're not going to go bust. They said, no, nothing doing. What was happening was we were depreciating our assets at some very high rates of depreciation. But the bank managers did not, therefore we did not have profit in our books, but we were generating our cash flow. And the bank manager's boss said, listen, how can you fund this? So they decided that and we were at that particular point of time busy putting up a new factory in Ambattur, and the work was going on. They said, sorry, we will not clear any of your checks. We were healthy because our depreciation was very large and we were generating enough cash flow. So we put up the Ambattur factory. In that particular point of time, there was a provision of law that you could pay 20,000 rupees in cash, and that was acceptable under the income tax department. And we therefore did that by paying every day 20,000 rupees to the contractor and finished the factory. So, and then anyway, fortunately for us, we came out of it. We were never particularly leveraged. But I still remember somewhere around 95, when we sold the business to Hindustan Lever, we had gone to the bank and asked for a small loan. And they said, look, you know, your balance sheet is not right, and so on and so forth. And when we sold the business for a substantially higher sum of money, then they put this as a case in their staff college, saying that, listen, we refused them a loan and the business was worth a lot more. In those days, brands were not valued. Now today, the brands are valued. But one big thing, remember, ultimately, products don't sell, individuals don't sell. If you're into FMCG business, it's brands that you sell. And I still maintain that. I could go and stand outside the shop for 3 days and say, please buy my ice cream. He will not do that. But moment you have a brand, the guy comes to you and says, listen, I will give me your brand of ice cream. So therefore, if you ever decide to get into business, please dominate the business and create brands. Do not think that selling helps. Ultimately, we individuals can't sell, but brands have a far greater valuation. So, all right, fine. Now I come to my second part of, or the third part. I had the professional life, I have the business life, and I still run a business, so that's okay. And I, therefore, 1995, I first time saw some money. And I decided to put majority of my money in the business, saying, listen, I'm doing it for my personal satisfaction or gratification to be active and so on. And I put part of majority of my wife's money into investment. And I knew nothing at all about investments, and I put them in fixed deposits, certificate of deposits, and so on. And somewhere around 97, 98, we had a neighbor whose son was working in a company called Satyam Computers. So I said, yeah, this guy is working in Satyam Computers, let me invest some amount of money in Satyam Computers. And then I realized these stocks were going up virtually 5% every day. And I said, this is very good. And I decided, therefore, to put majority of my money into the so-called software stocks. And this particular point of time, these stocks were going up every day, and I was a very wealthy man. I was a genius. And I did not know anything wrong could go on. So, Satyam or Infosys was listed in NASDAQ. And every day I would compare the prices of Infosys in India and compare its price to NASDAQ, and I'd find that Infosys was being quoting a 30 to 40% higher valuation in NASDAQ than in India. So I said, the Americans are smart guys, we are the stupid guys. If they are valuing it at 30% higher, then sure, I have got it wrong. And I therefore had this money, and sure enough, let's say if I started with, 6 rupees, let's say, okay, 6 or 8 rupees. By 2000, March or April, they had become something like 11 times. And I was a genius. And then came the dot-com bust. And the stocks fell and fell and fell and fell. And at the end of it all, what was left was 25 or 30 rupees. So it started at 6 rupees. And I ended up by 27, 28 rupees, but I had still made money. So my this particular investment group, where there's another very famous fund manager called Naren, he was also a member of it, and he was on the camp which felt that the software stocks were highly overvalued. He was also right, they were overvalued, but I hadn't done badly. I had also made my money 3 or 4 times in those 2.5 years, which is a mind-boggling CAGR. And then I said, I don't understand stock market, and I therefore decided to put back my money into, back into fixed deposits or debt funds and so on and so forth. But that interest in stock market was still there. And somewhere around 2003, 2004, I decided to go and buy a flat in Delhi from a company called Unitech. And I went to their offices. The offices were, most builders have very good offices. The project was nice, everything. So I decided to investigate a bit about the company. The company was available at a valuation of about 100 crores. And Citibank and some other two or three very major foreign fund managers owned 5% of the company. And I said, look, the office itself is worth 100 crores. I'm sure it's worth a lot more. And I decided to put some small sum of money, maybe 5 lakhs or 7 lakhs of rupees on that particular thing. And forgot all about it. Those days, I was not watching the portfolio on a daily basis and things like that. And therefore, in 2008, all of a sudden, there was this big boom on the real estate stocks. And this 5 lakhs or 7 lakhs had become almost 25 crores. So therefore, that was a great thing. I was also lucky in many other similar things which happened in this particular period. My wife used to bring a product called Fem Home, which is a bleach. And I saw this and I said, listen, this is a company which is probably will be acquired by somebody, having sold my business. And sure enough, it got acquired by Dabur, and money became 3-4 times. So I was perhaps lucky. I was also following what Peter Lynch calls seeing what sells. Similarly, there was another product called Neutralite, which my wife brought. I found out which company was making it, invested in it, became a 3-4 bagger. So the net result was I did particularly well from the period 2003 to 2008. And 2008, I built a case. I said, listen, everybody said Indian markets are highly overvalued. And I said, what are we talking about? Indian markets are not overvalued. Indian markets is only the beginning. A small company in America dealing with every product, niche companies are worth billions and billions of dollars. In India, we're still talking about these companies available for 100 crores or 50 crores or 70 crores or maybe 500 crores. India is going to be a country as big as America, and therefore this is going to be this. And how wrong I was. 2008, the so-called Lehman crisis happened, and stock markets fell all over the globe. The Indian small cap index from 2008, whatever time it did happen, I think it peaked around January 7th or 8th. And by March of 2009, the Indian small cap index had fallen by 90%. So if you had 100 rupees by March of 2009, despite everything that, you know, we talk about the big Indian story, if you had invested just in the index itself, you would have lost 90%. I had lost 75% of my wealth. And fortunately for me, I manage my wife's money. She does not ever ask me, what is the portfolio worth? Where have you invested in it? And, you know, our lifestyle has not changed whether we have the money or not. So therefore, that is okay. So nobody ever asked me whatever it is. But, you know, we held on to the business. And in March of 2009, I said, listen, I think this is just too much. I have lost too much money. And I started selling it. And when Rajiv Khanna starts selling, the stock market starts going up. And therefore, I was quick enough again to get back to the market. And therefore, I didn't, you know, life has been very, very kind. So let's say if I started with 6 rupees, today it's worth about 2,000 rupees. So therefore, it's a mind-boggling CAGR. Do I have the capacity to do so? I don't think so. It was a bit of luck, a bit of everything, but that's how well I have done. So that's what I'm writing. People put me on some sort of a pedestal. People keep writing about my portfolio and so on and so forth. I was invited by Kotak. I normally don't give interviews at all on my stock market, this thing. But I was invited by Kotak, and since I'd requested them for charity and they'd given me the charity, I could not refuse them, and so I had to sing for my charity. So I went there and I said, listen, I thought I will call this talk of mine as the power of stupidity, because I was in certain cases far too stupid, not knowing when to sell a stock, and therefore it held on and it did well. There is some merit in what I'm trying to tell you. There's a very large funhouse called Fidelity. And now Fidelity at one point of time decided to find out who the best investors were in their entire portfolio. And they listed out some 50 to 70 names, and they said, listen, let's go and meet them. What makes them great? And they went there and they found most of them were dead. So therefore this buy and hold does work. But on creation of wealth, there is something that you must hear, and this is the power of compounding. And this is the main thing in life, and I think power of compounding, Albert Einstein is rumored to have said that it's the eighth wonder of the world. And let me elaborate. It was around 1625 or 1630, the early Dutch settlers came to America and bought the Manhattan Island for a princely sum of trinkets which were worth about 24 US dollars, the entire Manhattan Island. The big thing in the stock market that is talked about is who got the better deal. They bought the Manhattan Island for $24, so therefore anyone you sell, listen, you know, Manhattan Island is worth a lot more. But if you put in that 24 US dollars for this period of 390 years or whatever it is, at 10% interest, today you would be sitting on 150 quadrillion dollars. And a quadrillion is something, a billion is something which is followed by nine zeros. a quadrillion is something which is followed by 15 zeros, and with $150 quadrillion, you can today buy almost all the assets in the world. So therefore, this power of compounding is something which works amazingly well. And therefore, first thing that you need to do is, if you're planning to invest, start investing at a young age. It helps a lot. I started at the age of 51, 52. Please, all of you, start investing, and start investing now. If you want to create wealth, there is nothing better than the stock markets, because it's a puzzle and you can do it. If you go and see the list of the top 200 Americans in America, at least 30 of them would be from the stock markets. These are guys who have the capacity to risk, and they have created great wealth. I'll talk to you on some of the great investors now. In India, we have this guy called Rakesh Chunjanwala. Now, Rakesh Chunjanwala is a chartered accountant and started with virtually no money at all. But he would, he was a great investor, capacity to take amazing amount of risk. Today, he's worth almost $2 billion. And there is an interesting conversation that he had. He said, when I got married, my wife was relatively from a well-to-do family. So she used to ask me every now and then that when are you going to get an air conditioner? And he says, I didn't know at that particular point of time when I'm going to get an air conditioner. But then he said there was a budget of Madhu Dandwate which came in, and everybody thought that Madhu Dandwate is a socialist, and I thought differently. I had worked out some equation of what caste or what type of family background that he came in, and I invested heavily at that particular point of time. He says that evening, the day the budget came, my wealth was 4 crores of rupees. I reached home at 11:30 at night. That particular evening, my wealth was 20 crores, and I told my wife, Rekha, ab AC aa jayega. So this is in India. I don't think, there's only one guy who's made money in the stock market, which is worth $2 billion, and none of us are close to $1 billion at this particular point of time, the next rung. So Rakesh Chunjanwala stands out for an extraordinary risk taker, but he has created that amazing wealth. We may not think much about his current set of investments, but nobody can take away that success from him. So therefore, that's one area who is a great thing. Warren Buffett, you people have all heard. He's an amazing investor. He was lucky enough not to get into Harvard, and therefore he went to Columbia University. There was this great professor called Benjamin Graham who was teaching there. Benjamin Graham ever gave an A grade only to one person in his life, and that was Warren Buffett. Okay, so therefore, Warren Buffett is an outstanding investor. In stock market circles, there is a theory called the efficient market theory, and people have won Nobel Prizes for this and so on. And there is a point of view that, listen, over long periods of time, you cannot outperform the market at all. Now, Benjamin Graham wrote a book called The Intelligent Investor, and I would urge every one of you to read that, because I think it's a great book. And in the present edition of The Intelligent Investor, Warren Buffett has written a chapter about various people who trained under Mr. Benjamin Graham. At least 6 or 7 of them, all settled in different parts of the country of United States, they had outperformed the market very, very substantially. Therefore, he debunks this entire theory of the efficient market. But Warren Buffett is an amazing guy, but there are others as well. There's another guy called Peter Lynch. Now, Peter Lynch is somebody I follow to a very great extent. He was a fund manager. Over a 15-year or 18-year period that he managed funds, his CAGR was much higher than Warren Buffett, but he worked very, very hard. He had 1,000 companies in his portfolio, and without computers, he could track it. And his books are extremely interesting. I would urge every one of you to read. Then there's another guy called George Soros. Now, George Soros is, again, an absolutely a remarkable guy. He was a refugee from Hungary. He did his doctorate in philosophy from, I think, Oxford or Cambridge. He's written a book called The Alchemy of Finance. and I request you to read it. I have tried to read it 4 times and I have not understood a single word of it. Absolutely none at all. But George Soros is known for various things. One is the time that when he broke the Bank of England, and the way it works is this, he felt that the British pound was overvalued and therefore the British government will have to devalue the currency. And the British government did not want to devalue the currency. So Mr. Soros kept selling the British pound and the British government kept buying it. But the pressure of George Soros was so high that the British government could not take the pressure and therefore the government decided to devalue the currency. On that particular one day, Mr. George Soros made £1 billion. That's a lot of money, a lot of money. And what is not known is that when he made that £1 billion, he had borrowings of close to £7 billion. And that's how big money is made. You need to take big time risks to make big money. So George Soros is amazing, absolutely. He had a guy who was working for him. George Soros would every now and then want get a successor for himself, a guy called Stanley Druckenmiller. So Stanley Druckenmiller one day said, listen, I had this particular position of close to $500 million on a particular thing which I felt was going to do very well. And Soros walks in and hears him out and says, listen, okay, yeah, that's a good position. And in a fraction of a second, he says, double the position. That's how quick George Soros is. He's worth about $28-30 billion. At one point of time, Stanley Druckenmiller told him, listen, I can't work with you and I'm leaving. So George Soros says, no, you don't leave, I will leave. So George Soros goes off to Europe. His pet hate is the communists. And therefore, for next 5-7 years, he was working, trying to fight the communists all over. And he left everything to Stanley Druckenmiller. Of course, he came back. Stanley Druckenmiller is also worth billions of dollars today. But these are the interesting guys. And since most of you are great, you know, mathematicians, there's another guy called Jim Simmons. Jim Simmons was a code breaker in the American Army, which meant that he broke the encrypted codes, how messages would be sent. And he got into trouble because he was not in favor of the Vietnam War, all that. But he, at some point of time, decided to leave the American Army and set up his own hedge fund. He did not employ a single guy from the stock market industry or from the Wall Street. He brought in pure mathematicians to do so. And he created certain algorithms. And what he has done over a 15 or a 20 year period, he has compounded money at 98% CAGR for the period of 20 years. This is a mind-boggling performance, absolutely. So if any of you like mathematical challenges, please emulate Mr. Simmons. He's also worth $20-25 billion. You understand what $1 billion is? These are mind-boggling figures. $25 billion would put you in the same league as Mukesh Ambani almost, who's worth $40 billion, is worth 1,50,000 crores. So therefore, that's the sort of money you can create in the stock market. Then there's another guy, again, I would like to, one last one, and that's a guy called Paul Johnson. Now, the time that we're talking about the Lehman crisis, there were some people who realized that the real estate industry in America was going to bust. And one of these guys was a guy called Paul Johnson, who read a hedge fund listing. The conventional wisdom at that particular point of time is that, look, real estate industry has never done this. Property prices keep going up and keep going up. Now, somebody found something called credit default swaps, and Paul Johnson bought it. And he was a loner, absolutely. He would walk into the office, and it was against all conventional wisdom that he was buying these credit default swaps. If things were so bad that his investors said, what the hell are you doing? He was spending other people's money. He could not face his own staff. They thought there was something terribly wrong with him. And he would come to the office and he would lock himself inside the office so that he did not have to face his staff. And till the 15 days before the so-called Lehman crisis happened, the entire Wall Street was saying, look, everything is hunky-dory. And then this entire collapse does happen, and Mr. Paul Johnson's company makes something like $12 billion in 1 year. He himself makes $3 billion. So if most of you, if you want to do that, of course, that doesn't cover him. But there's another book or another movie that's available called The Big Shot. Yeah, that's right. It's available on Netflix. Please have a look at it. But again, somebody's, but these are about different set of people. But I think it's absolutely amazing. So therefore, this is it. Now, what are the life lessons from my whatever journey, my roller coaster journey? Well, first, obviously, I think all of you live your dream. Huh? You only live once. Please go ahead and live your dream. Whatever you want to do, do it. Please, that's the first thing I would urge every one of you to do. I found this lovely quotation from George Bernard Shaw. A life spent making mistakes is not only more honorable, but more useful than a life spent doing nothing. So go ahead and do whatever you want to do. Please make your mistakes, live your dream. That's one. The second thing is give your life a best shot. You're going to live only once. Why should you succeed, to be honest with you? And what should be the metric for success? I don't think the metric for success should be the amount of money that you make. I think every one of you has the ability to success. If I see my driver, he's successful. If I see most parents bring up their children well, they're very successful. Therefore, the metric for success cannot be money. I mean, if you're doing research and you're doing damn good research, I think you're far more useful to the country or to anybody else or to the society than a guy who makes money. Therefore, I think the first thing we must remember that making money cannot be the metric for success. The metric for success is how well you've done based on your potential. We were lucky. We went into IIT. We were born in a particular type of family. So therefore, don't look down at the person who hasn't done well. Every man has a story to tell, and every man is successful who works to his full potential. And I think that's important. But you must attempt to be as successful as you are, because your parents expect it from you. Your institution expects it from you. Your country expects it from you, and the society expects it from you. Therefore, please do not waste your education. Please give life a best shot. You're going to live only once. But on success, there is also an interesting quote, and I would read it out for you. What is success? As I said, success at the age of 4 is not being in your pants, right? Success at the age of 12 is being a great cricketer or a sportsman. Success at the age of 18 is having a boy or a girlfriend, right? And success at the age of 50 would be to be on top of your profession. Then when you reach the success at the age of 75, again, is your ability to make it to your wife or companion. And then at success of age of 90, it's again not being in your pants is also a great success. So that's it. So work hard. And there is a Hindi saying called Khudi ko kar buland itna ki khuda puche teri raza kya hai. Basically translated, it means, oh man, raise yourself to such heights that God asks you what you want. There is no other, I don't know of any other way. Unless you work very, very hard, you're going to be successful. Bring all the passion that you can do to your job, and even if things are not good, you will gradually open doors. So therefore, you must be successful. Everybody, you know, you want you to do that. If you're an entrepreneur, it's going to be a very, very lonely life. You know, it's going to be tough. There's a book called Be Foolish, Stay Hungry. You will find it one of the most difficult things to do, but then it has a charm of its own. You live your life, you live your vision. You will feel very lonely at points of time, like a long distance runner. You weren't in a call. All your friends will be going on in big, working in large companies, living a good life, and here you will be struggling every morning, as I used to do. Go at 8 o'clock in the morning, come home at 8 o'clock at night. I used to go to Bangalore, take an overnight bus so that I did not have to spend for hotel charges there. And here I'd come from a multinational, which meant, you know, we used to all the good things in life. And then I would work the whole day, then take an overnight bus again so that I did not have to do that. So there's a certain this thing, what you wish to do. But if you have a dream, I think you should be willing to pay the price for it. But having done that, there will be points of time that when things just don't go your way, And I think that's what something which will test you like hell. And I think that's where you need your grit, you need your faith, you need your family support system, and therefore you must do that. And finally, what else can I say? There is a Latin term called carpe diem, which means seize the moment. So go ahead and seize the moment. Give life your best shot, and wish you all the very best. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The talk was very engaging. Now I would like us to ask some doubts to sir if we have any.
I'll be honest with you, I don't understand it very much. But you know, those who've invested, I've done well. We do not know when the regulators will put a thing on this, whether you're on the right side of the law, the wrong side of the law. In India, you'll be very, very careful doing that. But you know, it's something which, if you invested early and you made money, I mean, nobody, I realized one thing, never argue with success. Therefore, if somebody's made $1 billion, I say hats off to him. I don't understand it, so I'm okay. But
can you tell them how you pick your stocks now, like rain in the season?
All right. Okay. This is a classic example. I mean, I think, as I said, it's an intuitive process. It was last year in January. I met this friend at a wedding in this thing, and he told me there is a stock called Rain Industries. So I went back and studied it. This particular company makes some calcined pet coke and things like that, and he's got plants in America, in Europe, and all over. Now, the entrepreneur is very interesting. He went to Purdue University, came back to Hyderabad, and told his family members, I'm not interested in joining the family business, and he decided to set up a cement plant. And the cement plant became sick. But he heard that there was this particular plant available in America which was up for sale, which was making calcined pet coke. He went to America, convinced the financiers that, listen, I will buy this plant and you loan me the money for it. But if things don't work out, you will have no recourse to my Indian assets, but you will have recourse to my American assets. So he was good enough to do so. The fellow lives a very simple life, extremely dedicated. I've been told that he drives a Maruti in India and so on. So when I saw this particular company, this company had a market capitalization of 2,500 crores. And it was likely to make a profit of about 500 crores in the next 1 year, and it also had a depreciation of 500 crores, which meant it was generating 1,000 crores a year. Now, you know, one wasn't very sure, but to me it was a no-brainer. I did not get into anything further into what products it makes, what cycle it goes. Here I was going to buy a company of 2,500 crores, a guy who obviously had this great capacity to think out of the box and put up a plant in America, in Germany, ran his own trains and so on and so forth. That's the sort of manager I would like to partner with. So the stock was worth 2,500 crores and I didn't look back at all. And I kept buying this particular stock. I was fortunate also that at some point of time in the first week of March, I was also holidaying somewhere in Himachal, which was rare. And I had nothing to do, so I kept buying the stock from morning to evening, just as I've been buying it from morning to evening today as well. So this stock, which company which was worth about 2,000 odd crores at that particular point of time, fortunately for me, kept doing better and better. And today the company is worth 12,500 crores. So you made your money four times or five times, and you didn't need to understand what the product was. You saw, what do you do when you want to do? But the first question I ask is, if the business is available to me as a whole, would I buy it? Okay. And it was very clear. Look, I was getting, if he offered me the full business for 2,500 crores, I would be coming home with 1,000 crores a year. So I couldn't be wrong. And therefore, I bought this. And there was this great investor called Monish Babrai. I didn't know him at that particular point of time. He's based out of USA. His great claim to fame is he paid almost $1 million to have lunch with Warren Buffett. And he had also recognized the stock at that particular point of time. And he comes to India, now meets me. And somebody sent him a report on his email saying this stock is there. And 2 years earlier to this, he picked up 10% of this company based on this email from an unknown guy and so on. So he said for 2 years nothing happened, and then instead of God, Dolly Khanna entered the stock and the stock went up 6 times. So therefore you're gonna need a bit of luck, but that was it. So that was one, it was a no-brainer. So and why am I buying it today? The company's, the stock has reached a market capitalization of about 12,000 crores and I'm still buying it today. Because last week, 10-15 days back, it came out with results. The last quarter results were about 300 crores profit in one quarter. Now, the general view that people who know better is that they will make a profit of 1,200 to 1,400 crores in the next 1 year. They also have a debt of about 6,000 to 7,000 crores. Therefore, they will start repaying this. And therefore, I'm getting a company which is generating a net profit of 1,200 crores. In addition to that, 500 crores of depreciation, I'm generating 1,800 crores of cash profit. Generally speaking, a company growing at this rate will be valued at 18,000 to 20,000 crores. Now, I don't understand very many things. I think as long as I make my next 10-15%, I'm okay. So therefore, that's it. So that's how I invest. So the big question, what is value? There's something called value investing. But I think the big question that, which works well for me, I do all sorts of things, to be honest with you. I'm a momentum investor, I'm a value investor, I'm a growth investor. My job is not to be a prisoner of a style. My job is to make money. Therefore, I do everything that needs to be done. But, you know, this is one stock which has done well. So they've been similar good ones. It is not that I've not had my failures. I've had my failures as well. So, but overall, I think things have worked well for me. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
Can you differentiate the stop loss and the lockdown
code? Now look, I don't understand. These are stop losses are very technical terms, huh? But it's a good thing to happen. And I do follow a certain degree of stop loss. And my stop loss works not purely. I'm not a day trader. I don't trade on a daily basis. I don't have the skill sets for that. I'm not saying it doesn't work. But let's say, buy a particular stock and the stock over the next 2 months or 3 months goes down by 15% or 17%, I normally would exit the position. And the reason for this is that I feel that something was wrong with my thesis, that others have not bought it, and therefore there was something flawed in my logic. And I think it helps a lot. I think what's important in the stock market is not necessarily to find the winners, but to make sure that you weed out your losers much faster. And I think that works a lot more. The majority of my time goes around making sure that I remove my losers quick enough. And if on the other hand, at some point of time, they again start rising, then I again enter the stock. So I suffer from something called sleep apnea, which means I can sleep for about 5 hours at one particular point of time, and then I have to stay awake for about 2 hours. So I'm awake every night at about 3 o'clock, and 3 to 5 I'm awake. And therefore, out goes my email every night to my broker saying, please sell the following stocks. And I therefore learned this out. I disagree with Warren Buffett that you should buy and hold. Things that are not doing well, I need to get them out quickly enough. Yeah. But generally speaking, if you want to create great wealth, you've got to buy good businesses. You've got to find good managements who have a vision. Managements who will make the company grow faster. Now, I don't have the skill sets. I'm not a great businessman, to be honest with you. I do this to remain alive, to the thrill of doing whatever I do, whether to make cheese or ice creams or so on. It keeps me busy. But if you can find the person who you think has a vision, or if you have the vision, please go ahead and do it yourselves. But if you don't have it, then I think stock market is the best place. A lot of people think stock market is risky. I disagree with them fully. Look, if you ask anyone on the man on the street and say, listen, how are you going to make money? He'll say, listen, I need to set up a business. Now, all of us don't have the resources to set up a business, but what is available in the stock market, both India and globally, are some of the world's best businessmen. And you could partner them. And therefore, that's it. You should not look that, listen, I bought a stock. You're buying a piece of business. And therefore, you don't need to be a genius to recognize this, that if Indian economy is worth whatever it is, worth $2 billion, that thanks to all of you, this entire country is going to be worth, the economy is going to be worth $5 billion. Therefore, India is going to be a great place to create it. Now, if you have the skill sets, go ahead and set it up. And if you don't have the skill sets, partner some of the best businessmen in the country, and therefore you own businesses. I don't see myself owning a particular stock. I see that I am a partner to Rain Industries. Here is this great guy who can create a global empire, which I don't have the ability to do so, and therefore I'm partnering him. And as long as he does well, I'm okay. And there's one big advantage. I run a business and I'm looking for a customer. I'm 71 years old. For the last 1 year, I can't find a customer. But when you partner a guy like this, if he's not doing a job, you can get out of the business in a fraction of a second and get on to another business, which is far better. So I think it's an interesting thing to think about, but if you have the ability, and I'm not saying that you should all get into the stock markets, but if you're looking for the best salaries in this world, then the place to be is the stock markets. Because it's the only business where one man can create billions of dollars. I run a business, I need to have 500 people, 1,000 people to create wealth. But this is an amazing thing.
Do you use chart techniques for finding out the signals?
I'm afraid I do not use technicals very much. Huh? I have some idea if the stock is going up or going down. To me, that's too much of a micromanagement. But I do believe in, there's a guy called William O'Neill who's written some very good, interesting books, and he follows something called the Kanslim model. I follow it intuitively. I do not follow it rigorously. It's worked well for me. Yeah.
So, when you are investing in small caps, not much information is available in public, and whatever may be available, it might be that the promoter himself has given only the positive information. How do you separate the
day
from the
channel? I don't, but sometimes you get it wrong, but you start looking at it, you start looking at the business model over a period of time, you get a certain experience, eh? But things can go wrong sometimes, and this happened to me particularly with Satyam Computers once, and I have never traded, as I said. And it was only in case of Satyam Computers, I bought what was, on futures or something like that. And because I said it was a no-brainer, because the company was available for 700 crores or 1,000, I don't know what the figures were. And the company claimed that it had cash of 4,000 crores or something like that. So I, let's say, invested a crore of rupees. And in 5 days' time, that was worth 1.5 crores of rupees. And I said, listen, this is the first speculative income I've ever had, and therefore I'm going to buy myself a fancy car. And but next day, this guy, that very night, he announces that, listen, I'm sorry, all my reports were wrong, and I lost almost 70, 80 lakhs of rupees. So that was it, that's part of the game. These things do happen. But generally speaking, you develop an intuition. You see this thing, you understand what business is doing well, but all of us can make mistakes despite that. But that's the thing. I think you, with experience, you'll gain that. Interesting. Yeah. Okay. Two things. The best definition that I've read, and I think which should be followed, none of us can follow it. Best time to sell a stock is when it is not a buy. Theoretically speaking, when you see a company and you say, listen, it's a great valuation and I need to buy it, but at some point of time the valuation is written up and you say, no, I don't want to buy, then theoretically you should be selling it off and buying something else which is better. But I don't do that because markets very often tend to take it to great valuations and so on, and therefore, for example, I stopped buying Amar Raja batteries at 2,500 crores, but I didn't start selling it necessarily. And the market capitalization went to 13,000 crores. Okay, I thought it was, I remember there was a stock called TTK Prestige, and I bought almost more than 1% of the company, and I started buying it at 60 rupees, and I kept buying it at up to 400 rupees. And at 450, I thought it had reached a fair valuation. Today the stock is worth 6,000 rupees. So I therefore wait till the stock stops performing. I today look my portfolio as something which is being pulled by 500 horses. And I therefore tend to exclude out the horses which are running slowly. And therefore there's a bit of a technical that I built in, not the swiggly charts. And as Lynch would say, listen, all these guys say great things, but do one thing, take out 100 of these charts, show it to our technical experts and tell him that, listen, you think the stock will go up and go down, the odds are there 50-50, they will get it right. Huh? So therefore, I don't follow that, but I think that's the best definition. I don't follow it. I follow it when I find something better and this stock is started tanking. Or alternately, I also at that particular point of time see whether it's worth a buy, and I most of the time the valuations have anyway gone through fairly high figures, therefore you do this and you get into something else. For example, today I've been selling lots of stocks which are not doing well and buying Rain Industries because I think it will give me the next 10%, and to me a 10% is a great return in this sort of a market. So any other question? Yeah, yes, please.
As you mentioned initially, brand is important for the business. Brand is important for the business. So when did you realize quality was now a brand?
Our brand was quality, huh? Okay. And I think I learned it from my competitor. Arun Ice Creams was spending such large sums of money, and I was struggling, and I therefore decided to spend large sums of money. And then all of a sudden, sales started moving up. So therefore, I think we know that the brands are important, but we are not willing to spend large sums of money over it. Huh? It needs great amount of money to be spent. Building a brand is the most difficult thing to do because you know, if you're spending your money on intangibles, you don't know, you think you're wasting your money. There was a guy, I think it was one of the chairmen of Procter & Gamble. He says, I know that 50% of my advertising goes waste, but I don't know which 50% goes waste. So therefore, it's something which is evaporating into thin air. You don't know whether it's having any result. And the guys see the advertisement. We've been spending roughly 20, 30 lakhs on our milk advertising and not. And the end of it all, my accounts people say, sir, you're not doing well at all. You're spending money on advertising, what have you gained out of it? If I buy a machine worth 30 lakhs, I can see it there. So it's a difficult thing, but eventually that's where it works. Huh? But more on brand building, I have spoken to Mr. Chandramohan of Hudson, and he's come and agreed to speak to you. So I am sure you will hear his very, very inspiring stories. Because he started off with virtually no education at all, and as a timber market sales, and he's come and spoken to him. He was going to be here today. I said, I'm not speaking if you're coming here because he's such an inspiring figure. Fortunately, he's traveling. So therefore, he's agreed to speak to you. Huh? Yeah. So please come and hear him. He's one of the most inspiring because he's done amazing work on building brands and a great company. He's spoken at Harvard. He's spoken at IIM Ahmedabad. And what he tells me is that when he was 23, 24 years old, his grandmother removed all the ropes from the house, lest he commit suicide. So therefore, that's it. Eh?
Due to time constraints, we need to move on. I will once again thank you, Mr. Sir. Now I request Dean Ayania, Professor Nagarajan, to felicitate Mr. Khanna with a token of gratitude.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.